with our host, Dr. Michael Lenoir. Please stay with us.
And welcome to today's edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Mike Lenoir. Glad to have you back with us this week. Another special edition of, well, I guess it's not any special edition, it's the regular edition, but special. We have Dr. Mike DiGiacomo. Dr. DiGiacomo is a podiatrist in the Bay Area, so that if you have a question about your feet, you've been walking around with pain and discomfort, this is the man, this is the time to talk, and this is always a popular segment. So if you've got a question, it's better for you to get in early than late, because there won't be too much time for your question unless we get you into the mix as soon as possible. The number is 848-4425, the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008. Much too long, Dr. DiGiacomo. Welcome back.
Thank you. It's great to be back.
Are you always on the cutting edge? I don't mean that literally, but on the cutting edge in podiatry. Tell us what you're thinking about. What are you doing these days that you weren't doing 6-8 months ago?
Well, one of the things that we're doing is, we've been doing this for a while, but we're refining our techniques and using this ultra-high frequency sound wave therapy for plantar fasciitis or heel pain, as well as Achilles tendonitis.
Does it work?
It works really great. We got about a 78% success ratio nationwide, and I would say mine is at least right at 80%. So what happens is, for those cases of heel pain or Achilles tendon pain that just won't go away, we use sound waves that are so powerful that they are actually used to fracture kidney stones. It's called lithotripsy when you're working with the kidneys, and it's been around for 25 years plus.
Right.
But we've been using it more and more for the foot lately, and it does help people to avoid surgical intervention for a lot of problems.
So what happens if you miss the foot? I mean, is that powerful?
That's a good question.
You'd be pretty good at that, huh?
Well, here's the thing. The beauty of this machine is that we have ultrasound imaging. So if any of you have seen a ultrasound image of a baby before it was born, or a heart valve when the doctor's doing a cardiac look-see, we basically can image with ultrasound imaging to see where the painful spot is, to see where the thickening of the soft tissue is. And then it's an aim and it's a point and shoot type of thing. It's just you aim and you shoot the sound waves. It's about a 17-minute procedure. It's done with just a shot of Novocaine, and the patient resumes normal activities the next day.
All right. Well, let's give people some landmarks and some terminology, because a lot of people have foot problems, but they don't know what they have. Tell us a little bit, what is a corn?
Yeah, corn is typically an accretion or a buildup of skin, and that typically is on a toe. So if you have a toe that isn't perfectly straight and it creates a little rub spot, what happens is those skin cells get compacted down, and that will create something called a hard corn. If, in fact, you have a situation where you have two toes that crowd one another, such as your baby toe crowding too tight next to your fourth toe, there will be an accretion or buildup of skin there, because the bony prominences compact the skin cells, and they make a lesion called a soft corn.
What about a bunion?
A bunion is a frequently misunderstood thing. First of all, bunions, everyone should know, are hereditary in origin. They are the enlargement near the base of the big toe, and they are oftentimes seen with a deviation laterally of the big toe, which makes the joint more prominent. And again, a lot of times it is felt that, well, I wore bad shoes, or I grew up in poor times, and I was given shoes that were hand-me-downs, and they weren't the right fit, and that's what caused my bunions. But in fact, it really is hereditary. The evidence of that is that we can frequently examine people in cultures that are unshod or don't wear shoes, and they frequently will have bunion deformities.
What about hammer toes?
Hammer toes are toes that are basically just not laying flat to the ground. They are bent up, and they typically would have an appearance that would look, well, it's sort of like a hammer, I guess. But the thing about hammer toes is that they, too, are usually hereditary in origin. They are oftentimes made worse by a bunion, because with a bunion you get a lateral drifting of the big toe. In other words, the big toe drifts towards the other toes. It has a tendency to elevate them up in the air. And the problem that causes is that when the hammer toe is lifted up, it depresses or pushes down the bone behind it, and that makes a callus form frequently on the bottom of the ball of the foot.
And tell us a little bit about what fungal infections of the foot look like, and what are you doing for it these days that you always have a little something new for those.
Fungal infections of the foot, if they're involving the skin, typically start up as little watery, blister-like things that open up eventually, and then they resolve as scaly, dry, flaky-type skin. We always encourage our patients to not break those little blisters because it does have a tendency to spread the fungal spores. If you have a fungal infection in your nails, typically what you're going to see is a discoloration with a raised-looking area to the nail. There is a rule of thumb that if the one way to avoid this is to never wear the same pair of shoes 2 days in a row, because once the moisture dries out after 24 hours, the fungal spores die and you won't reinfect yourself. If you're having fungal infection of the nails, then we have topical medications that you can utilize for that, as well as an oral medication for the more advanced cases.
All right, one of the things that we talked about earlier in the month, we talked about the study that was recently reported that a lot of people buy shoes that look good to them but are not good for them. Has that been your experience as a podiatrist?
Yeah, frequently it has. In other words, I just had a woman in the office today. We were having the same conversation. She said, every time I wear this pair of wedge-type shoes, I seem to sprain my ankle. And a wedge shoe, of course, is elevated from front to back, and they typically are somewhat narrower in the heel, and that will have a tendency to accentuate the rolling off of the foot off of the shoe. Now, people that have really high arch feet are typically very prone to lateral ankle sprains. That means falling off the lateral side or the outer side of their foot. So one thing we always like to encourage people is that if you happen to go to a retailer and they say, well, you need arch supports, if in fact you have a high arch foot, don't buy arch supports, because that has a tendency to load more of the weight to the outer side of the foot, which can create strains over there, but more importantly can create an ankle tear of the lateral collateral ligaments, which frequently requires repair.
Well, what about some of the shoes beside the heel? What are some of the other problems that people make when they select shoes that they shouldn't?
Another thing that we do is we frequently look for style and we look for something that's flexible, lower heel and sharp looking. But these shoes are typically not good for walking long distances. Recently had a patient in who had been in Paris walking vigorously for 2 weeks at a time and trying to look like a Parisian. So she was wearing some very stylish little shoes that would look sort of like driving shoes. Mm-hmm. And she said the last week of her trip was pure agony. It was nothing but using ice and Advil and that sort of stuff. So the shoes that look like they're for style, or they look like they're for driving a car, little nubby bottoms on them and that sort of thing, those are not shoes that are made to be walking long distances. Those are made to be utilized for driving a car or just looking stylish when you're walking short distances. The other thing is shoes frequently these days are made of material that are man-made. And, of course, frequently they're made offshore in Asia and so forth. And man-made materials have a tendency to, number one, make your feet perspire. Number two, they hold the perspiration against your skin, which encourages fungal growth.
All right, let's start our phone calls. Let's go to Denise in Mountain View. You're on About Health.
Hi, I was calling to ask about plantar fasciitis and acupuncture and how you feel about the treatment or how they work together.
Well, plantar fasciitis, just for our listening audience, is an inflammation of the plantar fascia, which is the big ligament that starts at the base of the heel bone and goes all the way to the first bones in the toe. And so there are five slips of the plantar fascia going to all five toes. That frequently can get inflamed when we become inflexible. We don't do enough flexibility exercises or from wearing higher heel shoes, which shortens our calf muscle that then puts excess pull on the plantar fascia. So the hallmark of getting better with plantar fasciitis is not acupuncture, it is stretching. Remaining flexible and stretching that calf muscle is number one. If a person has a recalcitrant case of plantar fasciitis and you're looking for pain relief, acupuncture can help that. But the problem is that the plantar fasciitis will not resolve in and of itself with acupuncture. It will only be an adjunct in order to help minimize pain.
Thank you.
You bet.
All right, let's go to Tim. You're on About Health. Tim?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, doctor. My question is about my daughter. She's 10 years old, and I think about 2-3 years ago, she stepped on a shard, maybe from a broken plate, melamine kind of ceramic type of plate. And since then, she has periodic flare-ups of very localized pain and a nodule in the metatarsal area and the front one-third of the foot. And it comes and goes, and there's a nodule that is inside. that you can, one can feel it, and it's hurting. My question is, what options does she have in terms of investigations and or treatment?
In the way of investigation, if in fact it is ceramic or melamine, then you should be able, with good digital x-rays, be able to visualize the object if in fact it's there. So plain film x-ray with the digital equipment, which can be enhanced and colorized, will be the best first step to evaluate that thing. Now, the thing is, there could be a piece in there that the body has created a fibrous wall around. On her own, if she hasn't done this, I would consider for approximately a month spending about 20 minutes every day soaking this foot in warm water with table salt in it. Our bodies are made mostly of table salt, and this will help draw any foreign body to the surface. By and large, though, it sounds like at some point in time or another, she needs to have that little piece taken out, whether it is simply scar tissue from a puncture wound or whether it's scar tissue that's surrounded around the piece of foreign body. It probably ought to just be removed so she doesn't kind of learn to walk in a bad fashion.
All right.
And the surgery has no complications? Does it affect any nerve or neuroma in the future?
No, the surgery should not create a neuroma. Usually something of that sort, you will be able to visualize ahead of time where it is and simply remove what shouldn't be there. So with very careful dissection of the area, she shouldn't develop a neuroma or any other nerve damage with that type of a procedure.
And any podiatrist can do that, or... A special one? Or?
Well, don't go to a podiatrist that walks with a white cane. That would not be a good step in that case. Of course, I'm joking, but I would think any competent foot surgeon should be able to handle that, yes.
All right. Thank you, Doc.
Of course, sir. Good luck.
All right. 848-4425 in the 51 area code, 958-9008. We're talking to Dr. Mike DiGiacomo. He's a podiatrist with a great deal of credentials, been a guest on our program for a number of years, always a popular segment. So if you've got a question, 848-4425 is our number. Let's go to Red. You're on About Health.
Hi, Doc. How are you doing?
Good.
Dr. Giacomo, I was a patient a few years ago for Morton's neuroma.
Uh-huh.
And it had been bothering me many, many years. And you did give me a cortisone shot, which helped with the inflammation. And then you also gave me, like, a prescription for to get, like, an insert made on my shoe.
Right.
Well, okay, so then I got the insert, and they put a little pad on the insert itself, and what I found, long and short, is that I just ended up kind of taking the pad off and taping it actually to my foot so it would stay in a sweet spot and not move around as my foot would shift in the shoe. And then I found that as I moved the pad back and closer to my heel, it actually totally alleviated my... the neuroma to the point now that I actually can go like 6-7 months without the pad, and then only like when I'm spending an extraordinary amount of time walking on concrete or something do I find it re-aggravated again, and I just slap the pad on and in a day or two it's gone.
Yeah, that's the beauty of putting something directly on your foot, because you can get it in the right spot. Oftentimes, if you've gone to a vendor of some sort, a shoe repair shop or what have you, it's difficult for them sometimes to see exactly where the ball of your foot sits in the shoe, and then the pad needs to be behind that or towards your heel.
Oh, it's like right schnoogie up, right under, like, where the little spur that causes your heel bone or whatever that is.
Yeah, exactly. And that's, you hit the, when you call it the sweet spot, you got it right. So it is oftentimes a matter of trial and error. Sometimes people have to resort to getting orthotics, and even then sometimes it's a matter of fore and aft shifting in order to get the right spot.
Yeah, so that is, I'm just curious then, why does that help? Is the nerve that's being pinched, that's causing the pain in the toe, actually maybe being pinched closer to my heel?
No, what's happening is the metatarsal bones, which extend from about the middle of your foot towards the toes, are too close together in the front of your foot. And when you exert pressure back at the base of them, more towards your heel, you're spreading the knuckle part away from each other. And that
so
takes the pressure off the nerve.
Essentially.
It totally is. Totally a chain
kind of what I thought it was. And I had a debate sometime with some other podiatrist, and he just basically said the pad was just causing me to settle. It was like a subtle kind of brain signal not to step in a certain way and to guide my whatever.
No, chain rail, you hit it right on the head. You've got the correct idea there.
So it's been done before, so I can't come and show it to you and make an invention or anything like that, huh?
Sorry about that. I'm glad you're better, though.
Hey, Doc, this is the water guy, by the way. Hey, drink your water.
Okay.
Okay, bye.
Take care. Thanks for the call.
All right, let's go now to Pat. You're on About Health.
Hi there, doctor. I had my second bunionectomy on my right foot in May, mid-May. And it healed up fine, but whenever I exert any pressure on my right foot, like on stationary bike with some, you know, pressure on the pedal, I get a pain in the toe. So it's pretty striking pain. So I have been – so anyway, I'm scheduling to have the screw taken out. And I just wanted to make sure that that's a good thing to do and that will relieve my pain. My podiatrist felt like it could be the tendon, but he also feels that it's likely to be the toe. So I'm just curious what your reaction is.
Well, first of all, bunion surgery frequently can be, in fact, usually I do without putting a screw in there. But the thing is, if you're having the pain you're describing, what you'd have to look at is the side view x-ray taken of your foot to see if, in fact, the screw is protruding too low below where it was intended to be. If that's mm-hmm. the case, then your pressure on the screw, the pointy part of the screw, is in fact causing your problem. And taking the screw out should be a pretty easy matter of making you feel better.
Yeah, because he said, well, his reaction was is that I had some arthritis in the joint, and he feels that the bottom of the screw may be exacerbating that.
Yeah, that's so you, but you should be able to see that real well. On the x-ray yourself, and the doctor should be able to illustrate that to you. As I said, in my practice, what we use is a digital x-ray, so you can blow it up and you can see real fine detail and so forth. But even then, if you just look closely, the doctor should be able to say, here's the head of the screw, here's the flat part, here's the shaft of the screw, and here's the bottom of your bone, and see where this is actually sticking through the bottom of your bone, which is an inadvertent, you know, movement of the screw. So if you see that, I'd feel comfortable having it out. And in fact, if you've had the surgery 5 months ago, it's fine to take out the screw at this point.
Okay, great. Okay, well, are there any complications with getting the screw out?
I've never seen one. In fact, I take very few screws out because I almost never put a screw in a bunion surgery, which, and the reason I do that is just to avoid what you're having to undergo. But mm-hmm. the times that, like, someone has moved from out of state and had to have me take a screw out or something, I've never seen a problem with it.
Oh, that's good to hear. Thank you very much.
Yes, and good luck.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
848-4425 is our number, the 510 area code. 958-9008 is our 1-800 number. If you're outside the area, Dr. Mike DiGiacomo is our guest. Podiatry is our topic. Let's go to Marie. You're on About Health.
All right. Good. Thank you. First of all, it's just very good to listen to both of you. Thank you. And I'm calling because I had two neuromas in my feet a number of years ago when I had to be on my feet a great deal for work. And I went to Palo Alto Medical Clinic, and I saw a physician there. And he said, oh, well, these neuromas will never go away, so you need to have surgery. I went for second opinion and third opinion. Everybody said the same. And then it was decided I was going to have surgery. My physician then said, well, we could do both feet at the same time, which ought to have been the very strong message to me that I shouldn't even think of having anything to do with him, because it's pretty hard to manage without one foot, although I know there are people who don't have any feet at all. But however, so this I did go ahead with the surgery. I asked to see the neuroma when it was taken out. It looked like a very large a large pink pearl. It was completely smooth and pink. It actually looked good. Anyway, so I had seen the neuroma. And then, of course, I was going home and I used crutches. And I used the crutches for about maybe 8 or 10 days. And then I went back to the doctor. And I had, by the way, pain all the time, night and day, where that surgery had been. And I'm pretty resistant to pain, so I don't believe I exaggerate. But anyway, I did have a lot of pain in that foot. And then when I showed the foot to the doctor, he said, well, we could open it up and see what's wrong. And I then said, no, thank you. I don't want to do that. Anyway, after about 3 months, I was seeing him again. He looked at that foot, and he said, well, I don't know what's going on, that you have so much pain with it and whatever. And then I said, well, would you take a look at the other foot?
All right, now what question do you have for our doctor?
No, I'm just going to say this quickly, okay? So I give him the other foot where the neuroma had gone away. I had no pain in that foot. And he looks at it and he says, oh, yeah, nothing wrong with this foot. And I said, well, that's very strange since you told me that a neuroma can never go away. He said nothing from then on, all right? So this was the situation, and I believe it was partly relieved maybe from not being on my feet so much. But in addition to this, if I can say one more thing, I know I'm taking a long time, is that I've had times where I have so much pain in my right foot where that operation was that I cannot have any shoes on. I can walk very short distances, and it's just not a good situation. Right now, I'm in a good situation. I can walk well. But I thought I would really appreciate hearing what you think of that.
Yeah,
story.
Well, this we kind of talked about earlier, a modality known as acupuncture, which I'm sure most of our listeners have heard of. In cases such as yours where there appears to be an unexplained reason for pain, that is an ideal situation where acupuncture can be a good adjunct. So I would encourage you to talk to your primary care provider and see if, in fact, there is someone in your health insurance plan or available for referral. And I would give acupuncture a try, and I would give it at least 4 visits before you would, you know, make an assessment of how it's doing for you. But again, it sounds like you have pain, but right now we don't really have a good explanation for it, and that's an ideal circumstance for acupuncture.
Wow. Well, I really appreciate your saying that. Thank you
okay.
so much.
And good luck.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
All right. I think what do we have next, Marie? Bill and Fremont, you're on About Health.
Yes, I have a question about plantar fasciitis again. The doctor mentioned that one of the best remedies for it is to stretch the calf. Could he be a little bit more explicit about that, how stretching the calf actually helps to ameliorate a plantar fasciitis nodule? Like I have one about an inch below the ball of my foot, right on the tendon. And, you know, my only solution was for it many years ago was to have a custom-made orthotic. So could he explain a little bit more explicitly how stretching actually, does stretching actually reverse the nodule from becoming larger?
No, you have a different diagnosis, so we're not talking apples and apples here. It sounds like you have what's called a plantar fibroma.
Yeah.
And a plantar fibroma is a benign tumor on the plantar fascia that stretching would not help at all.
Okay.
And so the thing you need to know about a plantar fibroma is, number one, it's benign, as I said. Number two, if it's painful and very enlarged and an orthotic won't accommodate it, usually we just remove them. But the other thing you need to know is a certain percentage of patients, a rather small percentage, but roughly 10%, will also get these in the hand, and they create what's called a Dupuytren's contracture. And you can find that you won't be able to extend your fingers quite as well. So the one thing I always advise my patients that we've made a diagnosis of a plantar fibroma is, every so often, look at the palms of your hands and see if you find any nodules there. And do this test. Extend your fingers all the way and make sure you can get all those fingers extended all the way, especially the ring finger. If, in fact, you see that you have a nodule there, we usually encourage having a hand surgeon look at that sooner rather than later. But as to the plantar fibroma you have, there is no benefit in stretching, and it's simply live with it until you can't live with it, and then we remove them.
Yeah, that's what he told me. Okay, thanks a lot.
You bet.
All right, thank you very much. Let's go to Matt in Oakland. You're on About Health.
Hi there. I have extremely flat, narrow feet that I received surgery for when I was a child. I had a hammer toe. And that was helpful, but because my toes used to curl under. But now, as a 30-year-old adult, at the end of the day, on a nearly daily basis, my feet are in extreme pain from walking. And I'm wondering if you can recommend a certain type of shoe or insert.
Does your occupation or your profession allow you to wear any type of shoe that you like?
Yes.
then I would get a... First of all, are you relatively normal in your weight as far as for your height?
Yes.
Okay.
Definitely.
I would look at a running shoe. The ASIC, A-S-I-C brand, typically has very good shock absorption, but they also have good arch support. And I would,
ASIC.
Yeah, and the one that probably would do really well for you is the model called Kayano, K-A-Y-A-N-O. I would get a pair of those, and if that doesn't work, then I would visit a podiatrist about having some soft, custom-made orthotics. But sometimes the shoe alone is going to do it for you. But you haven't wasted any money or time if you get the shoes first, because the orthotic will still fit with that shoe quite nicely.
Okay, so the ASIC Kayano.
Right.
Okay, thank you very much.
You bet. And again, good luck.
Bye-bye.
All right, let's go to Sam. Let me get the numbers again. 848-4425 in the 51 area code. 958-9008 is our 800 number. Dr. Mike DiGiacomo, a podiatrist, is here with us to the end of the hour. And lots of good information. If you've got a problem with your feet, if you don't, you know somebody who does, just call them. Let them know what we're doing here on About Health Today. Let's go to Moore in San Francisco. You're on About Health.
Oh, hi. I just had a comment. I started to get plantar fasciitis, and I found out that statin drugs can cause that, and that I was taking a version of the statin drugs, and so I just stopped taking it and it went away. And I also felt that I had fewer joint problems after that. So yeah. I thought that might be helpful for some people.
Yeah, it probably is going to be very helpful. One thing it's statin drugs. And those drugs, just for our listening audience that aren't aware of them, those are the drugs that are usually used to lower your cholesterol. And the other thing that you can sometimes have with those is you can have liver abnormalities. So we always encourage our patients that are on those drugs to periodically have a checkup, which would include liver function studies to look at the liver enzymes. But thanks for that advice.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right, let's go now to Dave in Berkeley. You're on About Health.
Hi, Dr. Mike. Great show. I have toenail fungus, and I noticed that you mentioned both oral and topical treatment for toenail fungus. I tried them both. The oral had side effects, and also that the fungus returned after, you know, usage. The topical, you know, had limited success. I've heard of these laser procedures for toenail fungus that's been advertised on TV and radio. Do you know much about that, and are they legitimate?
Well, your key there was the advertisement, radio and TV. There's a big marketing blitz going on about that, and so far there have been no medical studies in peer-reviewed journals at all on the efficacy of this treatment. So at this point in time, they've come up with a laser that they theorize will help. They've had some anecdotal reports, but typically the feedback that I've gotten from patients that have gone for an exam is this is a cash and carry type of thing with no guarantees. And in fact, the only guarantee is that if it doesn't work, they'll do it again, but charge you 50% of what they charge you the first time.
Okay.
Now, that being said, the American Society of Dermatologists had their meeting in San Francisco in the early part of this year, and there was a presentation about two studies that are now going on with a different type of laser, and they will be in peer-reviewed articles, which would come out probably in late 2010. And once we see those articles come out in a peer-reviewed audience, and if they show effectiveness, then they're, number one, we'll start utilizing it. We'll promote it more in, you know, fashion like this instead of massive advertising in newspapers and televisions. And in fact, if it's legitimate, your insurance probably would cover it, so it won't be a cash and carry. The risk is all on you type of thing. So hang on to it and see what happens. Just wait, and I'll put some information out on KPFA if it looks like we've got some legitimacy to that topic. Now, one thing I want to mention to you, though, is this. If you have toes that are really bent down, then no matter what treatment you have, you will get a reoccurrence of your fungal infection, because the toes that are bent down mean that the toenails encounter the ground when you push off. And that trauma actually creates a loosening of the nail, which will make you more prone to fungal infection. So if, in fact, you or others in the listening audience have toes that have been down and you've had failure with treatment for fungus, it's probably a mechanical failure. It's not a failure of the drug or a failure of something you've done. And I have warned the biochemical people in the pharmaceutical industry that worked on these antifungal drugs, I said to them time and again that they needed to exclude patients with toes that are severely bent down from their studies. Otherwise, it's going to skew their results. It'll mean that there's a lot more reoccurrences. And somehow they only looked at it from a chemistry standpoint and never really took into the fact, the mechanical aspect. That's why when you go to a doctor, they need to kind of look at you holistically. They got to look at the whole picture and not just say, okay, I've got a laser and I'm going to aim and point it, you know, that kind of thing.
Right. What do you is there a certain type of topical treatment that you recommend?
I utilize just it's a cyclopirox in a lacquer base. A generic form of it now, but the brand name that originally was going on was Penlac, P-E-N-L-A-C. You do have to get a prescription for it, but it's
P-E-N-L-A-C.
P-E-N-L-A-C.
I see.
But it's very inexpensive now, and it is a time-consuming process. But again, right. If you have nails that are secondary to really bent down toes, I don't even think I'd advocate that.
No, they're not bent down. And in fact, I don't have much problem as far as it's mainly cosmetic.
I'd get your doctor to write your prescription for it and follow the instructions and give it an 8-month run, and you probably do fine.
Okay. Great. Thanks a lot.
All right, let's get the numbers again. 848-4425 in the 51 area code. 958-9008 is our number, 800 number. Dr. Mike DiGiacomo, we're getting calls from San Francisco, calls from Oakland, some from Marin. We got to go further north or further south. This is a real opportunity to talk to podiatrists. And so if you've got a foot problem, you know someone with one, or you've had one and things haven't turned out well, we got Dr. Mike DiGiacomo, a board-certified, very well-respected podiatrist, served on the podiatry board, was the podiatrist of the Raiders, I think, at one point in time.
Oakland A's.
Yeah, because who would make that association these days? All right, let's go to Gene in San Francisco. You're on About Health. Gene?
I'm sorry. Hello?
I'm sorry, Santa Clara. You're on About Health. Gene, your turn.
She dropped, so let's go to
Kamal in
Green Bay.
Kamal in Green Bay, you're on About Health.
Hello?
Yes, it's your turn, Kamal.
Hi, Doc. It's I'm a first-time caller, and I really do appreciate your show. I've got something. I was been diagnosed as a plantar wart under my left foot, and I haven't talked to. I mean, I went to an urgent care for it, and they gave me some numbers of podiatrists to talk to. But I read the information they gave me. They said, "Well, if you don't do anything in 1 to 3 years, it'll take care of itself, or you can go into treatment, which would take 1 to 3 months." I don't really know what the treatment might entail. Could you tell me a little bit about that?
Well, sure. First of all, let's go through what a plantar wart is. First of all, it sounds kind of mysterious, plantar wart. And plantar just means a wart on the bottom surface of the foot, just like the palmar surface of the hand would be the palm of the hand. They're more important because on the plantar surface, when you walk on them, you embed them, and it makes it harder to get rid of them.
Oh, I see.
So that's number one. Number two, it's a viral infection, communicable. You picked it up from someone else. You can give it to someone else. So we always tell our patients with warts, make sure you wear flip-flops anytime you're in a public place. If you're at the health club taking a shower, you're at the hot tub, you're going to the swimming pool, wear flip-flops right up to the water. And the next thing is that, you know, no matter what happens in the way of treatment, sometimes people just have a little glitch, so to speak, in their immunity that makes them want to get warts more often, or they're more able to get the wart virus. So I usually offer two forms of treatment for a plantar wart. One is a topical medication. It's called Effudex, which is a medication that we use for minor skin cancers. And it kicks in your immune response, and it makes your body want to just eradicate the wart virus. That is used under waterproof tape, and it's applied twice a day, and it typically would be a 6-week to 3-month process.
Okay.
The other method I utilize is simply just putting a shot of Novocaine under the wart using a little tool or an instrument that would essentially look like a miniature melon scooper. Just scoop the wart out and put a bandage on it, and that's that. That method is quicker, but it's a little more uncomfortable, and it is uncomfortable to walk on if it's a very large wart for anywhere from a week to 2 weeks. But you could still function and do ordinary daily activities. You may not want to do full court basketball 2 days after you have it done, but by and large, those are the two methods that work the best.
Okay, well, thank you.
You bet.
All right, let's go to Barbara in Oakland. You're on About Health.
Hello.
Hi.
Yes, this is Barbara in Oakland. Thank you, Dr. Lenore and Dr. DiGiacomo. The question that I have for you concerns bunions. I know you mentioned that earlier in the show, but I have a couple of specific questions. I have them on both feet, and it is genetic. And what I'm wondering is whether there are any options for correcting the bunion besides surgery.
Well, you know, it's an old joke, really, and I hate to say it in a way, but the option is to get different parents the next time around because, as you just alluded to, it's hereditary. So if you get a pick again, just, you know, check out their feet first. But here's the thing. Some bunions, although they're hereditary, are made worse by people who have flat feet.
I do have flat feet.
And so if you were to wear an arch support, either prescription or over-the-counter, then what it's going to do is it's going to lessen the pressure on the inner side of your foot, which lessens the pressure on the bunion.
Yeah.
And we frequently see people have good success with that. The next thing is if you have some curvature of the big toe that wants to drift towards the baby toe, we find that putting a toe separator in there, one, especially one made of silicone, which is comfortable, can also help ameliorate the symptoms.
And where do you get toe separators? Is that something over the counter?
Yeah, you usually will go into the area of the pharmacy where they sell foot devices and just get a toe separator typically made of silicone.
Uh-huh. The ones I've seen haven't seemed to work well with ordinary shoes, though.
Well, they come in various sizes. And I don't know what brand it is we stock in our office, but they usually are pretty acceptable. We find a lot of people use them with some comfort.
And I also have a quick question about what's the risk of surgery if I decided I wanted to do that? I've heard that you have to be off your feet for 6 months or something.
Well, the risks of surgery in general are the risks of swelling, which can go on for, you know, more months than ordinarily we would expect. It's normal to swell for a couple of months. Sometimes you can swell for 6 months, depending on how good your circulation is. The other part of it is that you can, and this is, again, risks, you can have stiffness in the joint that sometimes requires physical therapy after surgery.
Oh.
But the surgery, as I typically do it, is about a 40-minute, actually about 30-minute operation. It's done as an outpatient. You're asked to lie down and keep your foot propped up for 4 days. There's a cast put on the foot that's as big as a shoe, and you're on crutches for 1 week. The cast stays on for a sum total of 3 weeks. At the end of week four, you're encouraged to put sneakers on and get out and start exercising.
Uh-huh. But prior to the four-week period, you're basically doing are very limited because you've got the cast on and you're using crutches.
Well, keep in mind, your cast is on 3 weeks. You're only on crutches 1 week.
Oh, crutches.
And by week two, you can start walking and driving a car and that sort of business.
Uh-huh.
But if you had let's say you had an occupation where you worked in the post office, you stood it all day long in one spot or in a bank, or you were in an operating room as an operating room technician, those type of occupations are going to keep you away from work for no less than a month.
Uh-huh.
If you have the type of occupation where you sit in an office and you're on a computer screen a good part of the day, you can miss as little as a week and a half.
Oh, I see. Uh-huh.
And, of course, it all depends naturally as on your general health and your circulatory status as well.
Uh-huh. Okay, but during that period, you still have a period of months before you could, say, get back into a fitness program like aerobics and stuff like that?
No, that's what I was saying earlier. We want you at the end of week four, which is the beginning of week five, to get into those programs again.
Okay. All right. Okay. Thank you so much, Dr.
You bet.
Giacomo.
All right. Let's go to Berkeley. Talk to Aaron. You're in About Health.
Yeah. Hi. I want to share my successful experience in controlling toenail fungus. And that is, there's a Chinese salve. I'm not sure I'm pronouncing it right. Hua Tuo Gao. Hua Tuo Gao. Easily available in Chinatown, and I can tell you what the ingredients are. Aside from Vaseline, it's got benzoic acid, salicylic acid, camphor, something called, which they write as Serotinensis, which I don't know what that is, and then something I've never heard of at all, Chimone Anthus Praecox Link Oil. I mean, those are the ingredients, and it works. If I go a week without using it, suddenly my fungus gets bad, and if I start using it again, keep on using it, then the fungus goes away. It doesn't go totally away, but, you know, it becomes undetectable.
Well, that's a good tip. If you've had no issues with it, then maybe someone in the listening audience might want to pick up on that and give that a try.
Yeah, well, yeah, people should look into it. I don't know. I mean, I think, hello?
I'm here.
I was saying, if there is any negative thing about this, I don't know. So I mean,
well, the only thing that I can think of negative, and of course I don't have the ability to pull up all those ingredients, but the salicylic acid, I would just encourage that if it's an older person with circulatory problems, PAD or diabetes or something of that sort, I wouldn't use anything unless it was directed by your podiatrist. But if you're a relatively younger, healthy person, you don't have peripheral arterial disease, you don't have atherosclerosis, you don't have diabetes, I think it'd be fine to try that.
Yeah, okay. Well, I hope people can always check, I guess, and get more information if they have any concerns. But I have had no problems with years of use.
Great. Good. Thank you for that tip.
All right, 848-4425 is our number, and the 51 area code 958-9008. Dr. Mike DiGiacomo, our favorite podiatrist, our only podiatrist, really, is here with us. So you've got a few more minutes to join us. If you've got a problem, foot problem, those we've discussed, you've got some ideas about things that have happened or things that you want to happen with your feet, please give us a call. You got some suggestions. Some people shared their own theories with us this morning, Dr. DiGiacomo. You're welcome to call us. Let's go to Susan. You're on About Health.
Yes, thank you. I have a problem with, I have this thing on the bottom of my left foot that kind of looks like a plantar wart, but I've had it for about 15 years. And Kaiser told me that it was a corn and that all I could do was just trim it and use Dr. Scholl's, you know, that stuff you put on it, that liquid.
Yeah, yeah.
So and I wondered if there's any other fix or if that I just have to keep...
If you were to compare the size of that thing to the eraser on a regular number 2 lead pencil in the circumference mm-hmm. or the diameter thing, how much bigger or smaller is it?
I'd say it's a little bit smaller.
A little bit smaller? All right. Is it directly under a bone, like under the ball of your foot?
It's the edge of the ball of my foot, the outside edge away from the toe. So
okay. Good. That, you know what, if you were insistent and that thing was really bothersome, I'd ask them to just excise the thing. It's probably what we call a porokeratoma or a plugged up sweat duct, creating a little corn-like lesion. And if it's not under a direct weight-bearing surface, those can be excised, and that should help you feel really good.
I do put weight on it when I walk.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it kind of depends. Some days it bothers me more than others.
Well, the thing is, what I'm saying is, if it's not, you know, 100% under the ball of your foot, you say it's more a little bit on the periphery.
It's sort of twisted.
Then I still think you'd be a candidate to have the thing removed.
If
it's a bothersome enough thing to you. So you go to the podiatrist, Kaiser, and say, look, I've had this for many years. It bothers me, and why don't we take it out?
Is that just an office procedure?
Should be a shot of Novocaine, about a 5-minute operation,
a
couple stitches, and you're healed up in 2 weeks and good to go.
Oh, really? I thought I was stuck with this thing forever.
Well, no. And it's the old joke, too, not forever, just for the rest of your life.
Yeah,
why
right.
suffer if you don't have to, right?
Right.
Well, good luck with that.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Okay.
You got a lot of jokes here today.
Well, you know, it's...
This is one of the talents I don't think that I've capitalized on.
Yeah,
in past programs. So we'll have to figure this all out.
Some of them are older than others, yeah, I have to admit.
All right, let's go to Santa Clara, talk to Jane. But let me give the numbers first again. 1-800-958-9008. 848-4425. Dr. Mike DiGiacomo, our guest. Jane, you're on About Health.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, Jane.
Okay. I'm a lady in her 60s who has had peripheral neuropathy, not from diabetes, they can't figure out where from, for about the past 3 years. Then June 25th this year, something heavy fell on my left foot and fractured the third metatarsal. Since then, I've been doing the foot exercises and rubbing Toprosin, the homeopathic remedy into it, but there's a lot of swelling. It's hard for me to find socks that fit, and I'm kind of concerned about this swelling. Do you have any thoughts?
Yeah, the thing is, the fracture may be delayed in its healing if you're having an excess amount of swelling. But on the other hand, if you've had a crush injury frequently, that crushes your lymph channels in there and can create swelling that will go on for quite a long time. So the number one thing is push that swelling out of your foot. I would use a compression stocking or a pull-on anklet that will cover that area, and I would wear it daily until such time that you see some of that swelling go down. So that's the way you treat it yourself. But the other thing you want to do is ask your doctor, are you sure the fracture is healed all the way? Because sometimes swelling in light of a fracture means that, in fact, it underwent what's called a delayed union, and it's not yet healed all the way. And you may need more fracture care in that case.
Well, the x-rays, and they've done three, show that there is a union, and it was a puncture wound. It was kind of a sharp object. And when I put on tight hose and I walk, it cuts into the ankle and creates some discomfort.
In other words, this is a complete stocking?
Yeah.
Okay, here's a trick that you might want to try. Have that fresh pair of stockings or that stocking at your bedside and take your bath or shower, whatever you do, in the evening hours. Keep your foot elevated a little bit when you're in bed, meaning take like a folded blanket and put it about 3 inches thick under the foot of your bed, under the foot of your mattress, such that when you sleep, you're running a bit of fluid uphill. Now, that's okay to do unless you have any kind of a pulmonary problem, which creates shortness of breath or labored breathing. Have that stocking available and put it on before you get out of bed in the morning, and that should control the edema much better for you. And then ultimately, if we're lucky, you're not going to have to use those after maybe a period of a couple of months.
How about this homeopathic remedy called Toprosen? Have you heard of it?
I have not.
Okay. And somebody said, well, hold your leg into the air and then kind of like milk the ankle towards the knee.
Well, see, that's the same thing I'm talking about, but in my advice, you're going to be getting, you know, however many hours you sleep, you'll be getting passive gravity working for you. So that other advice is correct, but this way it's going to be like, well, I'm doing it every night for several hours.
Okay, so you're saying when I go to bed, tell me again.
No problem at all. Have your stocking next to your bed.
Right.
Take your bath or shower in the evening hours. Have the foot of your mattress elevated with a folded up blanket underneath it, so you get about 3 inches of elevation at the foot. So when you're sleeping, gravity's going to be working, pulling the fluid uphill for you, and then you're going to pull that stocking on before you've gotten up and steered around and taken a shower and so forth. And then you'll keep that fluid from trapping down in your foot so it won't be so uncomfortable in your ankle, and also so you'll fight the gravity again.
Okay, so I wear the stocking all day.
I would wear the stocking all day and only take it off when you're ready for your evening bath or shower.
And if it does continue to cut into the ankle?
Then you got to go to a custom fit one. And they make them in such a way that they can measure you every couple of centimeters and make a custom gradient fit. And in some cases, we even have people with mobility issues that they get them custom made with a zipper in them.
Ah, okay. And is there any test the doctor can do to verify that the lymph channel was crushed in the injury?
Well, the test is just evaluating you, and I'm relatively certain from what you've told me from the history of puncture wound that was so intense that it fractured a bone that you did crush some of the lymph channels. That's why you really got to fight this with external forces.
Ah, well, thank you. The Kaiser dermatologist or podiatrist never mentioned this.
Okay.
But my thinking is that it seems to be getting worse rather than getting
better. It will. Your tissues will just stretch and stretch and be allowed to accept more and more fluid. So you really need to stop the process.
Okay. What kind of specialist would be good to go to at Kaiser if the podiatrist has essentially said the X-ray says things are fine?
Vascular surgery.
Oh, vascular surgery.
Right.
Okay.
All right. Good luck.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much for that call. Let's go to Clovis and talk to Monique. You're on About Health. Monique?
Yes, I'm here. Thank you. I'm enjoying the show. Thank you, doctor. And I have a two-part question, if you have enough time. The first question is it okay to get pedicures every 2 weeks? I've been getting a pedicure for about the past 15 years, but I'm hearing a lot of negative things about pedicures, and I do use my own tools. I bring them every time.
Okay, and so... Okay. I'll answer the first question, then we'll get into the second one. So the first question is answered in this fashion. I see in my practice at least 3 new patients every week of the year that have infections and problems from pedicure salons. Now, the main one isn't what you think it would be. The main one is ingrowing toenails on the great toe because they seem to round the edges of the great toe. So if you are like a lot of listening audience and you insist on going and you really want to go and I can't stop you from going, tell them to make absolutely certain to file the great toe straight across. Do not cut the edges off. The other thing,
years. Okay.
Right. The other thing you should look for in a salon is they should have a throwaway liner to their baths. So if they have a filter, frequently what happens is the filter doesn't get cleaned enough, and that's when you hear these horrific stories that you've seen, even like the Barbara Walters had a special on one time. We lost a patient in San Lorenzo, California. She died after an infection from a pedicure salon a year and a half ago.
Wow.
So those two things, in addition to bringing your own instruments, you're doing about as good as you can do. So now you had another question, though.
Yeah, so my second question is, I'm young, I'm in my early 30s, and I'm really healthy, and I eat right, and I don't have too much salt. So here's the question. My feet, they swell up at nighttime, and when I wake up, they're swollen.
When you look at yourself on your height-weight chart, are you pretty good?
On my height-weight chart, yes, I am.
You're relatively normal in your weight?
Yes, I'm 5'6", and I weigh 130 pounds.
Yeah, that sounds very appropriate. So the thing is, you just may have hereditary weakness in the veins. The veins are the blood vessels that get the fluid from your feet and from your periphery back to your heart. And they have little one-way valves in them. And some people just hereditarily have weak valves.
Okay.
And those people are encouraged to just wear, in the beginning, you start off with just department store support hose.
Okay.
And if your swelling goes to above your knee, you should wear, like, pantyhose. If it's just to your knees, you can go thigh-high or knee-high.
Okay.
And it also works best if you do exactly like I was talking to with the other caller, and that is to put them on first thing in the morning before you get up and take a bath or shower.
Okay.
And as you alluded to, the really important thing on your own that you can do is the dietary thing of watching salt.
Okay. Is that the only thing that contributes to the swollen feet?
Well, it's obesity, heredity, and, you know, dietary circumstances are the general things that we look at.
Okay, and the information that you just gave me, is that would help control it?
Yeah, definitely would. And the thing is, and you, as you alluded to, you're young, and the point is, if you don't take some measures now, undoubtedly this will probably get worse as you get older, especially if you go through childbearing.
Okay.
So I would really start looking at it at this point in time and start off with the department store type hose. If that doesn't work, see a podiatrist or see a vascular surgeon and ask them for advice about getting prescription ones.
Okay. All right. That sounds good.
All right.
Thanks so much.
You bet.
All right. 8484425 is our number. The 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008. We're going to walk off here in just a minute. So before we do that, though, we have Dr. Mike DiGiacomo here for a few more minutes. So if you want to join us, you've got a problem, please do so. Let's go to Alameda to talk to Gil. You're on About Health.
Hello. I enjoy your show, and thank you for taking my call. My question is about athlete's foot. I'm a race walker, and I went on a walking tour this past summer in Europe for 6 weeks, where we averaged 7 to 10 miles. Now, when I got back home, my feet are peeling.
Okay.
And they're extremely dry, and it starts like little skin at the tip of the toe, and then the toes peel, and then my whole foot is just dry.
Okay. Do you have any itching associated with this?
Yes, at the bottom of my feet.
Well, the first rule of thumb is never, ever wear the same pair of shoes 2 days in a row.
Right,
so
yeah.
That's a number one. Number two, all leather uppers except for your athletic shoes for your daytime use. Number three, air and sunshine are good medicine. So if you can wear flip-flops and you're out of doors, that's a good way to treat that.
Uh-huh.
And number four, then you typically would go to one of the topical over-the-counter antifungals, the Lamisils, the Tinactins, that kind of thing. Okay. If that doesn't work, you better see a podiatrist or a dermatologist and see about getting a prescription-grade product.
Okay, so that is the dry skin is a form of
can be associated, because like I said in the earlier part of the broadcast, then frequently you start off with blisters that then goes to a dry skin itch type appearance.
Okay, thank you very much.
All right,
thank you very much. Let's go to Joanne and Clovis. You're on About Health.
Yeah, hi, thank you. I have a question about my 13-year-old son who has flat feet. And he plays basketball, and he notices that right below his knee, only on one side, it swells after he's been playing a game.
Okay, that is probably an aberration or an affectation of his growth plate in that area. So he needs to see an orthopedic surgeon about that and get an x-ray and get a diagnosis on it.
Okay, yeah. because his growth plate, they have said he has seen a doctor once, is not complete yet, so we've gone with the orthotic. But, you know, during heavy activity, he's experiencing that swelling. So
yeah, this may be one where, you know, a soft orthotic could be helpful, but it also may be one that it's beyond the realm of that. It may be just tincture of time where he's going to have to back off in activities a little bit till that gets more solid in there.
Okay, so an orthopedic surgeon then, huh?
For a knee, that's what I would do, yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Uh-huh.
All right, thank you very much. Let's see, do we have one more? I think we can squeeze. Again, we squeeze one more person in. Monica in Oakland, you're on About Health.
Yeah, hi for taking my call. I have numbness in the inner sole of my foot, heel. But I was in a car accident and hurt my back. What can I do for that?
I would, first of all, check with your treater, and you should have lower back x-rays evaluated to see if you had any subluxation that is creating a pinched nerve in the L4, L5, L5S1 area of your lumbar spine. If so, physical therapy, including spinal stabilization exercises, can frequently be very helpful. And if that doesn't work, occasionally a chiropractic type adjustment can help. But I would definitely have that looked at by a foot specialist.
Okay, thank you.
You bet.
Okay. All right, Dr. Giacomo, I think we probably run out of time for another call. Let's get some information about you, and would you be willing to take some calls from our audience in case they've got problems that they weren't able to share with us today?
Sure, I'd be happy to. In Oakland, my number is 510-465-8012. And I'd be happy to take some calls and send out some literature information if people have specific questions.
Anything left that you'd like to share with the audience about what we can look for in the future in podiatry?
Yeah, I think some of the things that we're looking at now is platelet-rich enriched plasma, which is coming on real strong right now for the treatment of tendinopathies. People with Achilles tendonitis and so forth sometimes are just simply not amenable to any other types of treatment. So in some rare cases, we've heard good reports, but not yet peer-reviewed studies on treatment of plantar fasciitis with this. But it's essentially a way of taking your own blood, spinning it down, and the platelet-rich plasma is injected into the painful sites. And we're starting to see, again, more and more peer-reviewed studies on this. And the next time that I'm on the show, we'll talk more about it because it's really at the forefront right now.
Yeah, someone was telling me, and maybe this is, you know, this was maybe just speculation from them, that once an athlete's had a real bad Achilles, it's just never the same. Is that correct? Or can you recover from a serious Achilles tendon injury?
You can. Dan Marino had an Achilles tendon.
Yeah,
I took care of one of the Golden State Warriors that when he came down here from Utah had a horrible Achilles tendon injury and quite a nasty repair. It just didn't heal quite as nicely as we would have thought. He was a very functional athlete.
Okay,
so you can definitely come back from those things.
All right, Dr. Mike DiGiacomo, once again, a very good program, a lot of interest, and thank you for joining us. I'd like to thank Mickey once again for her help and the Ethnical Institute for the support they give to our program. And most of all, let me take the time to thank you and our audience for making this such a good program. Remember, health is your biggest asset. I'm Dr. Mike Lenore. I'll see you next time.
Berkeley Farmers Markets, Halloween Day of the Dead celebration, Tuesday, October 27th, with Bahia Inc., free costume making, a pumpkin carving contest, a Day of the Dead altar. You're invited to bring an offering to add to our altar and jointly celebrate as a community that honors life, farmers' labor, and those that have sacrificed their health for our well-being and for food justice. For more info, www.ecologycenter.org. The Berkeley Farmers Markets are an ongoing benefit for the Ecology Center. El 27 de octubre habrá altar comunitario y exhibición de arte. Le invitamos a participar y traer una ofrenda para el altar y juntos celebrar como comunidad que honra la vida, el trabajo y labor de aquellos que han puesto su mejor esfuerzo por proveernos un mejor salud por medio de acceso a sus productos orgánicos y así contribuir a una sociedad sustentable. Para más información, llámenos 510-848-1704.
This is Free Speech Radio News for Monday, October 26, 2009.
This is listener-sponsored radio, KPFA or KPFB in Berkeley.